Take, oh, take my eyes away. Memory be racing, or myself I'll surely slay. Beyond my hair gazing, he came for our sakes, you say. God with manhood blending, but I call him break of day. Where night has its ending. Take, oh, take my ears away, that his words are hearing. As myself I cannot stay, if his love I am bearing. He is peace and love, you say, Godhood to man bending. Oh, I call him break of day, where night has its ending. Take, oh, take my eyes away. Memory be racing, or myself I'll surely slay. Beyond my hair gazing.
Wild about Harry, and Harry's wild about me. The heavenly blisses of his kisses fills me with ecstasy. He's sweet just like chocolate candy, or like the honey from a bee. Oh, I'm just wild about Harry, and he's just wild about me.
Jay Baba. Wild about Harry. All right. Well, I'm going to ask Jeff to go and unmute.
Boy, that was touching.
Thank you, Jay Baba. Oh, I'm so glad. Such a man. Such a lover of Baba.
I have to recover from that.
Take your time.
So anyway, Dr. Kenmore was, can you hear me okay? He was a larger than life personality. I mean, he was so fun to be with, I found, and entertaining, and, you know, and Baba loved his company. He loved his stories and jokes. And the Mondali said about Harry that there was only one other person who Baba gave freedom of expression to over all the years. And the other one was Dr. Ghani, his childhood schoolmate. And Harry could just say about anything. And Baba just enjoyed it. And he referred to Baba as Pop. My Pop. Now imagine a Christian or or the Buddhist or a Hindu referring to God in human form as Pop. But he recalled Baba Pop and he was his son, and they were the camaraderie between them was beautiful to when he would share that. Anyway, I think a lot of people, he died in, as we found out, 1971. So most of you didn't meet Harry, and it would have been unforgettable if you had. He gave these thunderous talks around the country in his, his belting, kind of Old Testament prophet, voice. But anyway, Baba referred to him as one of his intimate mandali, and his grave is at Lower Amaribot. He was buried with his grave. I don't know whether it's his body or maybe his ashes are there with the other men mandali at Lower Amaribot. And so I first met him in 1970. And his presence was the most powerful. He had the most powerful presence of anyone I had ever met. And I would find parts of my body just kind of dissolving being around him. I used to think he might be kind of like a veiled must who was disguised as a stereotypical New Yorker, bombastic, loud, insulting, opinionated, generous, independent, full of life. And yet from him came the most refined vibration. It's hard to imagine coming out of that personality. And Baba said it, he would be a perfect master in his next life. So he was no small fry, you might say. Anyway, I'm going to read something that to introduce his life, because there's something very, very interesting about this. This quote from Baba ties into his life, and you'll see that later on. Baba says, this is from Life at Its Best, the act of a perfect master is a creation of the utterly new, a descent of the truth into the false. Baba's talking about grace here. The act of a perfect master, or the avatar, as Darwin used to say, is a creation of the utterly new, a descent of the truth into the false. The redeeming act of a perfect master, or the avatar, is a flash of the eternal in the midst of what is otherwise nothing but rigidly determined causation. This is the mystery of divine grace bestowed by the perfect master. So I'll refer to that later because it links into his life. Anyway, Dr. Kenmore, some people just called him as the doctor, he was born Harold Lionel Klein. He was Jewish. His father was from Austria and his mother was from Romania. And they came to this country in around the turn of the previous century, and they settled into New York, first in the boroughs and then in Manhattan. Harry, if you're familiar with Manhattan, he grew up on 184th and West Side, West 184th. And he was very popular, very full of life, much loved by his schoolmates. He had a great sense of humor. He was a wonderful entertainer. He could sing. He learned a number of musical instruments over the course of his childhood, and he did a little acting, and he was a stand-in on Spanky and Argan Comedy and The Little Rascals. Now these are children, very popular children's shows that were in vogue before most of us, a generation before us. Like Tex Hightower followed all of these things. So he even got in on the movies, you might say, early on. But very generous, a natural leader, that he was much loved. And then in his middle teenage years, he had a couple of episodes of night blindness. And his parents took him to an eye doctor, and the eye doctor told his parents, not Harry, that he would be totally blind one day. He had a congenital eye disease called retinitis pigmentosa. Same thing that Lynn Ott had. But unfortunately, his blindness came much sooner. And he woke, when he was 16, he woke up one morning and everything was black. And he could feel the sun coming in through the window, and he could not see anything. And oh, he felt like he had been dealt a very cruel blow by destiny, by the universe. I mean, he was, and all of his great plans for life and everything was shattered. You know, all the great talent and abilities he had. And he said to his father, you know, what kind of living can I make being blind? And his father kind of callously said, get a cart and you can sell rags on the streets of Manhattan. I mean, that was a profession that blind people did do. But he felt that his father had very little concern for his blindness. And so he dropped out of high school and went out and started hopping railroad trains around the country. He called himself a hobo those years. And he was really fearless. I mean, for someone blind, I mean, he kind of wasn't tentative in his movements. Anyway, when he was traveling around on these trains, there was a traveling circus troupe that adopted him, and he became an entertainer. So he would get up and sing in front of these, you know, audiences, tell foreign stories, and he could tell jokes that in using the different dialects and accents and ethnic things, and very entertaining. In fact, I mean, that those years later, many years later, he entertained Baba with jokes and his funny stories. And that there was one guy in the troupe who was into the occult, and he taught him how to hypnotize people. And so Harry, I mean, he told me he could modulate his voice in such a way that he could hypnotize, you know, an audience and get them to do the funniest things, the foolish, you know, goofy things. And he also could put them all to sleep if he wanted. So he had some unusual talents, even from a young age. And then, but then after a number of years of just traveling around like this in this kind of adventurous life, he came back to New York, decided to finish his schooling and pursue a career, not knowing what a blind person could do. So when he came back, a couple of his good buddies from childhood helped him in his night classes. They would read aloud the textbooks and everything, so that he could get his high school degree. And then, I don't know if I'm exactly right about this, but I think one of his friends was studying to become a chiropractor and may have encouraged Harry to become one. So this is as I remember it, and his friend would read the text out loud, and Harry, anything Harry put into his mind to was intensified about 1,000-fold. He was very intense. And so Harry poured himself into chiropractic and that study. His friend, I guess, would give him a description of the x-rays, so he would know what kind of what was you know, what his, the people, what the patient was suffering from. Anyway, he was always very resentful of being blind, but he did as best as he could. I mean, truly resentful. And so then what happened is I'm trying to think of what year this would be. Let me see if I can. Well, he became a certified chiropractor in about early 40s. And he was became well known because he had healing abilities besides the chiropractic. And so what he was able to do, he told me he could see somebody from a distance and remote control give them an adjustment where they could hear their vertebrae click into place. And he told me that a lot of the patients that came to him were possessed by entities, and he learned how to cast out entities from people. I mean, he, like I say, he had all these kind of abilities. And then around the same time, he went to a place called the Lighthouse for the Blind, and there he met the woman who was to become his future wife, a woman named Barbara Israelson. And she introduced him to spirituality, and this he took to that, and reading all sorts of things. He would have people read aloud to him and everything. And he would go, he began meditating. And he told me he meditated for 10 years. Now, for Harry to meditate for 10 years would be like equivalent to 200 years for most people, because he was intense. And in one of his meditations, he said that in a deep meditation, suddenly he could see the room he was in. He could actually see. And then he went out, and he could travel around. And so he went out into his neighborhood to see what it looked like. Instead of having to learn trial and error through his blindness what the neighborhood looked like, he went around, all around, to see the places he went to, so he could see it all visually. And so he was seeing with his inner eye, which was not handicapped by his physical blindness. And it's, I'm trying to think. Oh yeah, one of the things that he did was he got into. I remember him telling me that at one point he came. Oh, he broke into the subtle world, and he said it was. He called it the Garden of Eden, and the fragrances were like nothing here on earth. And the sights and beauty, it was so beautiful. Now, he's doing this all kind of on his own. And at one point, I remember him telling me that he came to the temptations of the powers on the fourth plane, and he had to kind of push past that. And I was kind of new to Baba. I'd only been into Baba for a couple of years, so I wasn't able to ask him about these things. You know, I just didn't know enough to ask questions. But here was the thing that happened is, at one point he got into his past lives, and he could see all of his past lives, and he could see how everything unfolded and the law of karma and everything. And he could not see any reason for his blindness. There was no karmic reason for his blindness. And he was infuriated. I mean, he knew enough about the law of karma by this time and getting access to his past lives to know how karma unfolded. Well, that infuriated him all the more. But eventually, what happened is that that now we're getting into the early 50s. And at one point, Adele Walken came to him as a patient, and you know, and somehow she, I guess she mentioned Baba, and she also had Margaret Crass come to him for treatment. And they, you know, they told him about Baba. He took instantly to Baba. And in fact, Margaret Crass used to go there and read the discourses to him aloud. And then when they got through all the discourses, she said, Margaret said, all they did is talk about Baba after that. He got the discourses, but Baba the man is what he was into. So then Baba came to, this was, when he heard of Baba, it was like 2 weeks after the Three Incredible Weeks, which was 1954. So he missed that opportunity to see Baba. But 1956, Baba came to New York first, and he met Baba in the Delmonico Hotel and Longchamp's restaurant. And then Baba went to down to Myrtle Beach. I mean, Baba went to Myrtle Beach, and then and Harry went down. So Harry, when his turn came, he was brought into the lagoon cabin. And after the, you know, the usual exchanges, he very seriously said to Baba, Baba, why did I become blind? And this is, I wrote down what Baba said to him. Baba said, if you had not become blind in this life, you would have become a great world-renowned surgeon, and then you would have had no reason to search for me. I created your blindness. I gave you these Vidyani Sanskaras so you would have to meet me in this advent. I'll read that again. If you had not become blind in this life, you would have become a great world-renowned surgeon, and then you would have had no reason to search for me. I created your blindness. I gave you these Vidyani Sanskaras, which are the ones that he gave to the Mandali, so you would have to meet me in this advent. If he had been a world-renowned surgeon, he would have been at the beck and call of all the wealthy, rich, and royalty of the world, and would have been so caught up that he wouldn't have been able to break away. So then after this, Baba had a second accident in India, and Baba would not, the Dr. Donkin and Dr. Gower were insisting that he get a surgery and have it fixed, you know, have his hip, you know, worked on and everything. But Baba said he was not going to have any surgery. And somehow they got his permission for a chiropractor to work on him. And there was a chiropractor in Calcutta, but that was just too far away. But then Harry heard about this, and he offered his services. In fact, Harry had been working on a type of chiropractic for about 10 years. He said it wasn't even just chiropractic, it was something different that was ideally suited to treating Baba. I mean, he you know, so Harry came. Baba, in 1957, I guess shortly after the accident, I don't know how long. See, Baba's hip, his bones had set improperly, and Baba was in excruciating pain. He couldn't walk. I don't think he could sit without being in pain. So anyway, Harry comes. He brings his chiropractic table, sets it up in Mandalay Hall, and he begins working on Baba four times a day for probably an hour each time. And he is very meticulous, and he is working, you know, on Baba's body, on his right side. And the way I kind of picture it, I don't know if this is exactly right, but it's like Baba's femur was not in his hip socket. It was on the rim of the hip socket, which was excruciatingly painful. And so Harry's whole objective was to bring his socket, you know, I mean his, yeah, his femur down into his socket. Once it was in the socket, Baba would be able to walk again. Baba would be able to bear weight without excruciating pain. But he did this very meticulously over time, and you know, Goer was just weeping with joy. To see Baba walking again. And Erich wanted Baba Harry to live there because he could treat Baba and, you know, just be there all the time. Because he got Baba gradually taking a few steps, and Padre bought a bicycle into Mandalay Hall, dug a hole in the dirt and had a bicycle so Baba could do exercises on the bicycle. But I'll tell you though, Marizot up to that point was very kind of quiet and everything, but Harry had this booming voice. And when he was treating Baba, he would, you know, he would be telling stories and jokes and everything with Baba. And the women all the way over in the main house could hear him. I mean, it was like radio, it was, you know, resounding all over. And I'm going to kind of just finish up here at this point by saying that these are the kind of remarks that he would say to Baba when he was working on him, his kind of constant, you know, talking. Baba said, how do you like Marizot? And he says, Marizot is a wonderful place. They're wonderful people, wonderful food, wonderful accommodations. And there's a wonderful guy that runs this joint. That's kind of the way he talked with Baba. At one point, he's working in Baba, and he says, I just figured out the difference between you and me. I am a zero, and you are the one. And another time, he's working on Baba, and he says, oh, and I wanted to add to that. You are perfection, and I am a perfectionist. And at one time during these sessions in Mandalay Hall, he said, you know, Baba, you're the big clam, C-L-A-M. You have clammed up for 30 years. And when you open your shell, a pearl is going to fall out, drop out. And Baba said, no, not a pearl, the pearl of pearls. And on another occasion, he was working with Baba, and Baba was standing, and Harry was checking how he was bearing the weight on his right leg. So he's down on the floor, you know, trying to judge from Baba's leg, and he says, now remember, Baba, when you feel peeved by the Mandalay and you want to give them a swift kick in the pants, use your left leg, not your right leg. So he had great freedom with Baba and the camaraderie. And I think, I mean, he changed the whole atmosphere, kind of a fun time there at Marizot. He stayed for a month, and at the end of the month, Baba was able to walk again, you know. And he so his whole life, that blindness was just the you know, got him to do this thing. And he came again and again to see Baba. I'll just tell you one last way he came. Harry calls up Baba and says, Baba, can I come and see you? Baba's at Guru Prasad. Where are you? I'm in Bun Gardens, which is only like a half a mile from me. So he came all the way and didn't even tell Baba. So he had, like I say, a lot of great freedom with Baba. And I wish you folks could have met him, those who didn't, because he was some people were a little bit intimidated by him, but I found him, I was used to kind of the New York personality, and I wasn't put off or intimidated by it. But a great, great thing. And he was immense help to me in my life. But that's it now for now. J. Baba,
Jeff. That was just fabulous. Thank you so much. What a great bio. What a great understanding of a great man. I just love the lightness that you bring to the story and to his, and that Baba brought, that he brought to Baba.
Yeah, he
lighten up.
Yeah,
I can just feel it as you were talking. Thank you. Well, I'm just looking around here and seeing if anybody wants to share. Ira, I don't know if you're willing or have some. Yeah, yeah, good. Go ahead. You're unmuted.
I was at a meeting with Dr. Kenmore meeting, and I was in the audience. The doctor had an office on the second floor of 121 West 72nd Street, Manhattan. Now we never met, but I was just in the audience. And when he spoke, the thunder of his speaking just, it ripped through me. The thunder of his voice ripped through me. And what it is that the composure he had, okay, was an inspiration to me, especially that, so after his talk, there was a person arguing with him. And I said to myself, how can somebody argue with a blind man? It was a sympathy that I had, but Harry took it so nonchalantly, you know, with perfect composure. And so just that one meeting, I was in the audience, it was an inspiration to me. It was a tremendous inspiration. And that's what kept me, you know, yearning for his inspiration was like a shot to me. It gave me a shot, you know, to follow that arrow. And now you see, I was going to college on West 70th Street, like two blocks away from Harry's block on 72nd. And once when I was a student, I saw Harry walking down the street, you know, with his cane. And I think, you know, when at that time, when I saw him walking down the street, he looked so fragile at that time. You wouldn't believe it was him. And so in this group, the Society for Mejor Baba, what they did was that Harry gave talks on Saturday nights, and they taped the talks. The talks were on tape, and they became the way and the goals. Hey, the way and the goal. So then the group, they had the tape, and they typed up from the tape, they transponded or something, or so they copy the tape into typing. They type the tape, okay? And that's and that is the source of the way and the goal. So the way and the goal, that's the way Harry talked. It's that's his words verbatim. Okay. And if you read that nobody else has Mayor Baba like he does. Okay. If you read those way and the goals. Okay. Well, see, back in those days, we didn't have much to read. Okay, so I must have read those Way and the Goals maybe about four times. Okay? That maybe 12, 13 issues of them. It was just, you know, just the experience. I just think just the experience and the inspiration he gave me See, I still feel it, you know, I can still feel being in that room with him and the thunder of his voice. The thunder of his voice would rip through me, just rip through me like that.
Yeah. And Ira, if you think of anything else later on, don't hesitate.
Yeah, right.
There's also a website that Prakash just put up of the PDF of The Way and the Goals. So if anybody wants to, I'm going to copy it and put it in my email so that I can go there and read it. Thank you. I hadn't known that. That's really cool, Ira.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I love the way you talk about his voice.
Yeah, right.
Jay Bava. Tina, have you anything you'd like to share about your time with Harry? You need to unmute.
Not really. I avoided him because I was terrified of him. You know, and I had a lot more contact with Anna Rosa. I was only in the society a very short time, a couple months, maybe 3 months, I don't know. Mm-hmm. So I'm sorry I can't really say much.
Yeah, I hear you. You had mentioned something about him treating you.
Well, Anna Rosa said I should go and get treated by him because it was a rare opportunity. So I'd never been to a chiropractor. So I went and, you know, I didn't have anything wrong with me though. So, you know, but Alex Sprinkle, he said, like Dr. Kenmore, he healed him of seizures.
Wow.
And he had some condition that was causing it. And I don't know, I don't have any of the details, but yeah, I wish I could think of more.
Oh, that's okay. You, how many times do you think you went and saw Dr. Kenmore?
Maybe 2 or 3 times. You know, I don't know. I had to get the x-rays and I was so young. I was doing anything Anna Rosa told me to do. I was just, you know, kind of like putty in their hands. And, you know, it wasn't that he was mean. It was just that he was very, very loud. And forceful. And he would give these talks and, you know, you could hear him, you know, all the way down the hall as you got out of the elevator.
In the next building. No.
Probably, yeah.
Well, it looks like Michal has something she'd like to share. Go ahead, Michal.
It's just that I read the book, Harry.
Yes.
And wow, it's such a beautiful book and it's big like his size. And the stories are just wonderful. Oh yeah, this book, look, yeah. And he is something quite, something different. And it's so joyful. It was so joyful to read about him. And his personality so strong and so brave, and wow, it's wonderful to read that book, and I do advise everyone who likes it to read it. It's just wonderful, and I like that Baba has all these people. You know, it's not like a club. You know, it's not cut down to a certain way of behaving and a certain way of clothing and a certain way of talking. And he has these big people and different people and he allows us to be us.
Yeah. That. So true. Eris used to say the sign that you're in the court of the avatar is unlike other ashrams where they're mainly spiritually minded. In the court of the avatar, the entire family of humanity shows up. You know, all paths are available, you might say. But I'll tell you one thing about the book, Harry, is that he brought a tape recorder with him. So all of those times that he was with Bamba in India for good periods of time. The sessions in Mandalay Hall he got on recording with Eric translating what Baba was saying and what he was saying, a different one. So that's something very special.
Where are the recordings?
Larry Karish has the recordings. Mm-hmm. And in that book, there are a number of
many
recordings
of them,
right. He's excerpted in, yeah.
Wow. Prakash?
Jay Baba.
Jay Baba.
Well, I don't have any personal experience, but while Ira was talking, I tried to look for the book he mentioned, the volume. And I thought I just looked at one page and I found something that I thought I could quickly share. And let me just quickly do that. So here in this particular book, The Way and the Goal. So here he goes. I recall Pukar weeping when I left India in 1959. Baba sent me around to embrace each of the Mandali, and he was going to have the last embrace. He embraced me first and then went around to embrace the Mandali. Then he embraced me again. And then someone said, oh, we forgot Kaikobot. So he was sent forth. We embraced each other, and Baba had to be the last one to embrace me again. That was the third time he embraced me on the morning of my leaving. And there was Pukar. It was all in tears. Baba said, what have you done to Pukar? All in tears? Pukar turned to me and answered, Baba has turned me into liquid. So that's one small incident. And then there's one more little one here, holding on to the Daman. And so can you take eternity? That's a question I think here. He says, the Daman is only a symbol, but to me personally, it's more than a symbol. This is, I think, Harry talking. In 1957, Baba literally picked up his Daman and placed it in my hands. He took the hem of his sadra and had me clasp it. He took both of his hands. He took both of his hands and clasped them over my hands. He said, I want you to hold on to that. Hold on to it real tight and never let it free. He said, even if you let it go, I won't let you go. So that's what I thought I'll quickly share.
Hey, you know, I just happened to think of something I should have mentioned, is that that Harry had all of these kind of psychic abilities and be able to read people's minds and all of that. But after he got into Baba, he said Baba put a curtain around him and he lost the conscious use of all of that. All he said, I'm just in a little room and all I can do is remember Baba and talk about him. So Baba, you know, closed all those things that he had developed in his life before Baba. Baba put a curtain around him.
You know, Jeff, I had also heard the same thing with something similar with Fred Winterfeld, that he also had some abilities, and after Bob, when he came to Baba, that kind of ceased.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Same thing with Phyllis Fredericks. She asked him to. Yeah, she asked him to close some of the abilities that she had because it was too much for her.
There were still some residual abilities in Harry, but I don't think he was consciously encouraging that in himself anymore.
One more thing, okay, is that one of the most famous talks of Harry was like after Baba dropped the body, Harry was given the thought. Harry thought that Baba was going to embrace him again or somehow contact him again. He had that thought. know, that Baba was going to contact him again, but yet Baba dropped the body. So now Harry is staying in Mayor's Yard. This is after Baba dropped the body. And Erich walks with Harry down the Mayor's Yard Road. And all of a sudden there's this farmer comes out of nowhere with very soft hands and touches Harry's cheekbones like Baba did, you know, to see how well Baba, to see how well Harry shaved, something like that. And then that farmer disappeared, you see, but Harry's sense was that the hands touching him and the way the hands touched him was the same way Baba's hands did. So that was Harry's like darshan, or his contact with Baba. Oh.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah. And to say, just to add to that, but you know, when Harry was there in 1968, Baba told him to come back and he would see him. And so when then Baba dropped his body and he wrote to Erich and said, am I still supposed to come? And you know, and so Erich said yes, but come after the last darshan, come to Merzad. And so that's when this episode happened, on the approach road to Merzad. But very uncharacteristic for a farmer to approach Erich and a Westerner and come up and actually touch his face and everything. When he left, you know, Harry said, who was that? He said, that was a farmer that came in. Where is he now? And Erich looked and he was nowhere to be seen, and there were just open fields. He said, that was not a farmer. Those were not the hands of a farmer. I mean, Harry, you know, his whole life was touch. And so they had him come back and tell the women Mandali. So he, you know, they felt Baba had met him and met him again as Baba promised he would, one last time. So that, I'm glad you remembered that, Ira.
Yeah, that's beautiful. As soon as you did that thing like this, Ira, I just felt it.
Baba, he did that with Lynn Ott too, to see whether, being blind, whether they had shaved proper, you know, got all the places, because.
Feel Baba's face, he said. Feel my face, Baba said. See how well I'm shaved? That's what he said to Lynn Ott, so that Lynn got to touch Baba's face. What a gift.
You know, when I was there, I mean, unless someone else has their hands, when I was there, early on, Harry said, what are you going to do with your life? You know, and I said, well, I don't know. You know, I was kind of thinking I might try to, you know, I want to be a writer. You know, what have you been writing? And I said, oh, I've been, you know, trying to write this and that. But I was kind of afraid to show my stuff to anybody, you know. But then Harry says, do you love writing? And I bent my head down. It knocked me into such a deep state. And I looked up and said, no. And he said, yeah, if you loved writing, you would be even writing on the napkins in restaurants. You know, you would be so obsessed with it. So he relieved me of the kind of oppressive kind of lack of success and everything of trying to be a writer, really. And here's another thing that, but I was always like, what am I going to do with my life? What am I going to do with my life? That was my agonizing question. And I would come and he would say, Jeff, what are you going to do with your life? You know, one time he said, you're just a mad dog roaming the face of the earth, you know, like a and I would walk away and I would be completely free of worrying about what I was going to do with my life. And it would last for about a month. And then the agony would start to build up again. And I'd go in there and he'd blast me again. When I walked down on the streets of New York, I was just like free of that for a while. I mean, every time I went to see him, he would just blast those sun scars of what am I going to do with my life, agonizing sun scars. He would just blast it away. So, I mean, and someone might be intimidated by that, but I actually, you know, I felt the liberating blast from him.
That blast, like, it erased sin scars.
Yeah, it just, well, when he would say the master's prayer, I mean, anybody can jump in here, but don't hesitate. Otherwise, I'll give you a little. When he would say the master's prayer, and Baba said that he would go up 7 flights to say the master's prayer, meaning he must have been saying it from the soul. He would go, but when he would say that, and you would be sitting in that little hall, a little room, it would like a hurricane came in and laid waste to everything, and even the shutters on the house, they were gone. I mean, it was like everything was devastated. And you were left with this kind of peace. There was hardly a sanskara floating by. You know, it was just for a certain time being. But it would scare the heck out of it. I mean, it would go right through you like a train that, you know, just shooting right through you on the railroad tracks or something. You probably remember that, Ira.
Yeah.
I was saying that Ira and I had a full head of hair before we started going to hearing those prayers, and look what happened to us.
Wow. Thank you, Jeff.
Sometime, if anyone had, I can tell you how I kind of came in contact with him, but I'm not going to do that if there's anybody else.
Well, Mahu just put her hand up.
Oh, good.
To share. Go ahead, Mahu.
I didn't meet Harry Kenmore, but I like to ask you a question, Jeff, because you were in close contact with him. Beside the master's prayers that I've heard from others, especially in East-West gathering, Baba asked him to recite the master's prayers, and he did it so powerfully. I've this heard it from several sources. But other times when he was talking to you, do you know what was the reason that he was talking with such a strong, like a thunder voice? I mean, you really thought he was working on your sons. I mean, and was he like this to everyone or just a few people that he was close to? That's my question.
Well, he was hard of hearing a bit, so his volume was a little bit higher than most. But the thing about Harry is there was no inside or outside. What you heard from him is how he felt. I don't like that. Why are you doing that? That's stupid. You know what I mean? There was no doubt about how he felt about anything. The inside and the outside were one. That's rare. Most people have their inside, they're feeling this, and then they express that out there. They're at variance. But with him, you know, it was one and the same. So you got a good reading. I never doubted about how he felt about me, you know, or how he felt about anything. I don't know if you could make your way around the world. You could make your way in the world with a job if with that type of personality, but luckily he was self-employed.
Just one little comment. If we talk like that, even, you know, our friends, Babalars, will say, oh, you haven't been tactful. You speak like this, you hurt somebody's feeling. And they bring that, you know, saying Erich talked about tact in his book.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was very popular for a while. It was getting just circulated among some Babalars. you just don't know how to talk. You've got to be tactful.
Yeah.
But of course, we're not Harry.
Yeah. Yeah, no, you might say he was tactless, but he had your best interest in mind. He was a very loving person coming out through a very gruff personality. I mean, great love. I mean, Baba said he's going to be a perfect master in his next life, so he's teetering on the borderline between the finite and the infinite, trying to keep from falling in, you might say.
Def, there's a question from Martha. She asks you to describe any sensations that you would have had after a treatment. And please describe a treatment.
You know, I never had a treatment from him.
I didn't think so, but I thought I'd ask.
I, in fact, I didn't. I wasn't even thinking along those lines, and my body was fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Meher Prasad, if you would like to go ahead and speak.
I actually have a question. I'm wondering if Harry met his parents after he met Baba.
I don't think he did. I don't think he ever went home. He changed his name from Klein to Kenmore, partly because the prejudice toward Jews, but also just, you know, he kind of disavowed his parents.
Wow.
So he changed his name to Kenmore. Yeah.
Wow. And it looks like Fred's here, Fred Stankus. You want to go ahead, Fred?
Yes. Hi, Che Baba. Hi.
Hey, Papa.
I listened to a recording tape of Harry Kenmore giving a talk, the public talk, and then there was somebody saying, I'd like to know about Meher Baba. This question, Harry Kenmore shot back and said, it's Meher Baba. And then another person said, what is the thing about using drugs or alcohol? And Harry shot back, he said, drugs or alcohol destroy the cells in your brain and eventually you'll become weak but he would just, in a tirade, he would tell these people at a public meeting. So I recall that. I just wanted to share some of his feelings in the public even.
Yeah.
Thanks. All right, Betty, go ahead.
Jeff, you mentioned that he hopped trains for a while. How? Yeah. He was blind, right? Was that possible?
Yeah. He probably got help from anybody. I don't know how he did it, but it was the hobo period of his life, hopping trains.
Wow.
And until he hooked up with, linked up with that that traveling circus.
What a young life, Mike.
Oh, he was truly fearless. I mean, one time he was walking along the street and there was an open elevator shaft and they hadn't pulled the gate across, and he walked right into an elevator shaft and fell down two floors.
Whoa.
He picked himself up, got back up, and went to his clinic and treated one of his next patients.
Whoa.
I mean, two flights, and you know, you can't even defend yourself because you don't know what is up and what is down.
Also,
I read
the book. I think it's the same thing, but as he was falling, he said, damn, or something like that. And then later on, he said, it's lucky I didn't die because my last word would have been damn.
Oh, he was just a character.
Oh, I love it. I'm so grateful that Baba had people like Harry Kenmore. It just makes me feel more open and expansive in myself, which I'm sure Baba would love.
I'd watch him and he'd lean against somebody there at the table. See, after the meetings, he would order all this food from a local deli. I mean, mountains of food. I mean, it must have cost $1,000, you know, every Friday. And But anyway, and then afterwards we'd sit around and people ask some questions, and he would do something like this. I watched him. He says, "You're living with her. Why don't you marry her? You know, just right out." Or, "What? When are you gonna give up drugs?" You know. But he'd lean his head over there, and you could tell he was picking up. I mean, just insulting. I mean, I really felt for the people. You know, just oh God.
No, but you're right. It's like a Synscaric blast. You know, we all need that. It's so cool.
Oh, he was.
Betty, you got something? I would
quickly, I missed a little part of your intro. How old was he when he left his parents' home?
16.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, he dropped out of high school and got on the road, wow, on the rails.
I hate to admit that I wished that for myself. I always thought I'd be a great bum on the railroad. Of course. I don't want to say it out loud because next life I might have to listen. But, you know, just it's just so exciting, and to do it without your vision must have been just incredible.
That's living the new life, the gypsy life.
Yes.
Jeff, Judy has a question. Okay.
What's that?
Go ahead, Fred.
I have a question where Jeff was describing the experiences on the subtle world. Did Harry regain his sight when he was in the subtle world?
Yeah, when his inner eye was not handicapped by his physical blindness. So when his inner eye opened in the states of heightened meditation, he could actually see his room and see everybody. And then when he came back down from meditation, he was blind again. Wow. I don't know if that makes sense, but.
Yeah. Yeah, well, Fred's muted again, so I think that made sense, uh-huh, to Fred. Yeah.
Oh, yes, that's amazing.
I know. Yeah.
He said that up to the fourth plane he experienced, but he didn't cross over to the fifth.
I think he must have, but I didn't know enough about planes. I didn't know enough about God Speaks to ask what he was doing there. You know, he just told me he was confronted by the temptation of the infinite power of the fourth plane, and he somehow pushed past it.
Well,
and he wasn't in contact with any spiritual master or anything. He was doing this independently.
Yeah, that soul was so ready. There's actually something going subtly on here because two people have the same direct chat to me, direct message from Marge saying, "How did Jeff meet Harry?" And then 2 seconds later, Judy Robertson says, "Ask Jeff to tell the story of how he first met Harry."
Okay. So I was in Seattle out and you know, Judy Robertson, Mayor Prasad's territory in Jai. And a buddy of mine and I, his parents had gone on some mission work in the Asia. So we had a huge house on Queen Anne Hill, and we used to have these gatherings, and they weren't spiritual gatherings, they were just kind of people together, and there were only two of us who were Baba lovers, and this buddy of mine and I, every once in a while, we would, and this is 1969 or 70, we were, you know, only been into Baba for a couple of years, but we would feel a presence in the corner of the room, whatever room that the people were in. And it was a very benign presence, but you know, we could say, "Hey, the thing is here," you know, and it would be there for about 45 minutes and then it would go. And it was benign, we knew it wasn't Baba, but it was, you know, somebody. And occasionally that presence would be there and one of my eyes would start tearing, you know, just one of my eyes. And I didn't know what, we were new to Baba. Who knows what goes on with this whole Baba thing. So anyway, we had this life for about a year. there. And then one morning, we had all these friends and did things together. I woke up one morning and I got this message that I have to leave Seattle by 12 o'clock. And I didn't ever get stuff like this before. I said, folks, I got to go. I'm out of here. So I went up to my parents. They were in Vancouver, BC. I thought maybe I was, being told by Baba to go to Myrtle Beach. I'd never been there before. But anyway, so I got up to Vancouver. I got a rent-a-car, made it all the way into New York. When I got into New York, I looked up in the phone book and I was hoping to find out the name of the Monday night group. It was just called the Monday night group. I didn't know the official name of it. And that's where I heard of Baba. So I looked up in the phone book and it said Society for Avatar Meher Baba. And so I thought that was, I would call them and see if anybody was traveling from Myrtle Beach from New York down to Myrtle Beach. So I called and I got Anna Rosa on the phone and I asked her, and she asked anybody going to Myrtle Beach. There wasn't anybody going to Myrtle Beach, but she said, but one of Baba's Mandali is here. Would you like to meet him? And I said, sure. So I got on the next subway and I came down, and I had never heard of Harry Kenmore. I didn't know anything about him, but I came in there. And in the waiting room, and he was finishing up with his patients. And when I was in the room there, boy, I mean, it was like colors, like beautiful colors and everything in this waiting room. I'm thinking, who is in there? What kind of person is in that other room? So eventually saw his last patient, and Anna Rosa escorted me in. So I came in. I didn't even know Harry was blind, and it was hard to tell that he was blind because he was so familiar with everything. Plus his eyes looked right at you, with with comprehension. So I sat down and he had a little desk. It's the desk that is at the gateway now. It's a little desk that I often sit behind. And he starts asking me about my life. And he's asking embarrassing details. The last 4 years of my life is embarrassing. And I'm having to admit to these things right in front of this guy I've never met before. And I mean, like, he knows my life. It wasn't like he was psychic. It's like he was, been following my life. And I realized later that that was the presence that was in the room there, looking at us in Seattle, that benign presence. And I was in there for about 45 minutes. It was almost like it was in there for about 200 years. So anyway, that was my introduction to Harry. So I decided, well, I'm gonna maybe that was why I left Seattle, to meet this guy. So he was I don't know if this is for public consumption, but when I was whether I was physically with him or away from him, he dissolved about 95% of my physical awareness. And I would tell my friends, I only weigh a hand. I weighed practically nothing. I had my physical sensation was gone, and I was just floating around. I wasn't in a transcendent state. I was kind of right there, but I didn't have any. A lot of my sensation of my body was dissolved by his mere presence that it was emanating from him. I mean, I don't know if this is the kind of stuff I should really share, but we're talking about Harry, and this is the kind of stuff that happened to me around him.
I think it's great you're sharing it. Just trying to imagine what that must have felt like.
He was all Baba's. Boy, he was in the largest sense, I would say.
Okay, Prakash, go ahead.
No, just wanted to ask Jeff or anybody, did he explain his first experience of meeting Baba? and what did he feel, I mean, generally?
You know, I don't know. I don't recall his saying that, but you know, that little scene there in the lagoon cabin, he shared that, but maybe someone else did, but I, okay, yeah, Ken Nunzig had some experience with him, yeah.
We can't hear you. You're unmuted, but we can't hear you.
Oh yeah, this is a good story. If we can get him.
Maybe he needs to go out and come back again.
Can you hear that?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. We got you.
All right.
Hi, Ken.
Hey.
Jay Bobber. Yeah,
I never actually ever spoke to Harry. I knew nothing about him. But he was my Baba connection. So I'll try to make a brief version.
No, it doesn't need to be a brief.
We want the long version, Ken.
Please. So, where were you born?
Bird at birth, yeah.
Yeah, I was born, I lived upstate New York mostly. I ran off to California in 65 and passed through again in 67 and saw Baba's name and photo, but had no idea this was, you know, he's a spiritual person. And so anyway, in the meantime, I did TM and had some experiences and I was coming out of my psychedelic period. So November 1968, I only realized recently it was my birthday or the day before, I was in Manhattan. And I assume, I guess I was waiting to take a bus to visit my second cousin who was at Brown University probably. And I had nowhere to spend the night. You know, I was like between buses. So I didn't want to hang out on Port Authority too much. I was just, you know, I was wandering around New York City and looking at this nice church on Fifth Avenue or Sixth Avenue and sitting on the steps. It was about 7:45. And these two young men walking down Sixth Avenue stopped and I had long hair and a beard and this big old coat and, you know, in the middle of my hippie phase. And they stopped and said, do you know what time it is? And I sort of laughed like, no, you know, what, you think I have a watch? What kind of person would have a watch, you know? And so then they sort of paused. They sort of paused and looked at me and said, would you like to go to a meeting? I had nowhere to, nothing to do, nowhere to go that night. Sure. They're rushing down Sixth Avenue. See, I didn't know at the time, but of course, I guess Harry would lock the door at 8:00. So they, you know, they were worried they weren't going to make this meeting. And apparently it was a big deal because Harry had literally just come back from being with Baba. It's November 1968. And Baba had just announced that he was going to allow darshan. So there's all these young people that have not met Baba and now they're going to have an opportunity to go to India and be with Baba. So they're telling me about this Meher Baba and they say, I heard his name, but I had no idea. And one of them just, you know, we're still walking. We haven't even gotten to the meeting. And he says, and he's God in human form. So I had hung out in Berkeley and seen some different groups and stuff and thought, oh, there's another cult, you know. Like, we're all God, I'm thinking. And as I'm thinking that, the fellow furthest from me leans forward as we're walking down the street and says, I know we're all God, but he really is God. Like he's read my mind. So that kind of, that's kind of odd, you know, like maybe it's still be interesting after all. So we get into this meeting and it's the society meeting and Harry Kenmore and he's gives this whole rap about, you know, the two things I remember he's saying, and you've got to go right to India, come right back after you see Baba. And, you know, it was like a little too whatever for, you know, a hippie to take in. And then he was talking about, and this book was written and, you know, he said, what? Baba, the author asked Baba, what should he name it? And Baba said, Mayor Baba, but he named it the God Man and should have named it. But Baba said everybody was seeing Baba's name. And so it was all sort of fundamentals in a sense. You know, Harry is very loud and forceful. So I had no idea what anything was going on, really. And it was only recently when the book Harry came out that I realized that it was my birthday, November 12th, my 23rd birthday, 1968. So what a birthday present that I'd never realized I got at the time. And we get to the end of the meeting, and of course, Harry was famous. I'm sure somebody mentioned it with the Parvardhagar prayer. So he booms out the Parvardhagar prayer. And I always say, there was such a presence in the room. There was such an energy. There was such a power. It was like nothing I'd ever really experienced. And I always say, it's like I had, you know, I didn't know what the hell it was, but it was something for sure. And, you know, it was, now I realize it was Baba, really. He was bringing Baba there. You know, he had literally just come from being with Baba a couple of days before in India. And so that was really my first Baba experience. And then afterwards, we went to a little cafe, two of the people and one other person, which turned out to be Michael Mathias, if anyone knew him. And they were telling me more about Baba, and I looked over. One of them had a Baba button on. And I still, it must have been the Ancient One picture, but it, you know, I felt like it was a picture I'd never seen before, because as I'm looking at it, Baba just removed a couple veils. And I recognized him somehow, you know, as the Christ. And I wasn't really a Christian, so I don't know why that was the experience, but. So they let me come back to their house in Brooklyn, I think it was, and they had all these big black and white Baba posters on the wall, and I couldn't relate to them, though. You know, it was too much. And I went on my way, and I didn't hear for 6 months that Mayor Baba had dropped the body or anything like that. But that was kind of the seed, you know. It was planted very deep. And then so then I came across Baba, a friend gave me some of the discourses, and I started reading them, and I got some pictures of Baba, and, you know, meditating on Baba. And so then, well, let me figure this person out, you know, because I had pictures of different gurus and I, et cetera. And of course, Baba was, you know, there was nothing to figure out. It was just an ocean of love. And his eyes were infinite pools of love. So by 1971, I got to the point where it's like, well, you know, I tested him intellectually and all the other ways that I could, and it was kind of like, I guess I should take this seriously if I'm going to get any further. You have to sort of step beyond the mind and the intellect. But anyway, so Harry was the vehicle.
Beautiful. Wow. And amazing that these two guys would be walking by Port Authority at the same time.
And yeah, well, it's actually on some church steps in Sixth Avenue, I think. Uh-huh. You know, so not too far where they were going. Yeah, but they were running late, and yet they stopped to talk to me.
Yeah. Incredible.
Obviously, it was meant to be. Yeah. That I had just happened to be in that part of Manhattan that day.
Yeah. And plenty of time on your hands. Yeah, no, beautiful.
Yeah, thank
Very
you
touching.
For the description.
This is how.
And my birthday, I'd only discovered.
Yeah.
Happy birthday.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. That was fabulous. Thank you, Kent.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mayor Baba. Mayor Prasad. Go ahead.
You just remembered this in the book, you know, Harry would get into, when he gets into a cab, he would ask the driver, can you say the name Meher Baba? And the driver would go, what? And he would repeat, can you say the name Meher Baba? And then the the driver would say, you know, something like, if he mispronounced it, no, it's not that, Meher Baba. And then the driver would say that, and then he would tell him where to go.
Yeah.
I love that. That's very cool. Let's see. Oh, Jeff, someone, Judy wanted to know where you had heard, Jay, where did you hear that Harry would come back as a perfect master? Where did Baba say that?
I heard that from Larry Karish, who's, and I don't know if it's in the book. maybe Mayor Prasad might know, but Larry Karish, who is really basically kind of a son to Harry, told me that.
Uh-huh.
He's the one who, he and his wife were the ones that wrote the book. I don't know, like I say, I don't know if it's in the book itself, but he told me.
Okay.
And about what, whatever he was not quite a normal human being.
It was not in the book, but in the book it does say that Baba told him that he's one of the Mandali.
Yeah. Intimate Mandali. The Mandali is Baba enjoy, you know, you enjoy Baba and Baba enjoys you. And Baba feels comfortable with you and you feel comfortable with Baba. That was one of the definitions.
Well, I loved in that slideshow, there was a picture of three men in striped coats with their hats, straw hats.
Yeah.
They were singing Swanee for Baba. And oh, that's Harry in the middle singing.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that. That was a beautiful show you did. With, and the beautiful song, Take, Oh, Take My Eyes Away.
Yeah.
Memory be erasing.
Ruthie, could we see the slideshow again? I think there's many of us that
missed. Oh, good.
Okay, all right.
Great idea.
Is this a good time?
Yes.
Go for
all
it.
Right. All right, I'll go for it. Just gonna mute.
Take, oh, take my eyes away, memory be erasing, or myself I'll surely slay by unmeher gazing. He came for our sakes, you say, God with manhood blending, but I call him break of day, where night has its ending. Take, oh, take my ears away, that his words are hearing, as myself I cannot stay, if his love I am bearing. He is peace and love, you say, Godhood to man bending. Oh, I call him break of day, where where night has its ending. Take my eyes away, memory be erasing, or myself I'll surely slay by on may her gazing.
I'm just wild about Harry, and Harry's wild about me. The heavenly blisses of his kisses fills me with ecstasy. He's sweet just like chocolate candy, or like the honey from a bee. Oh, I'm just wild about Harry, and he's just wild about me.
Sorry, took a minute to get back. I just have to say thank you to my husband because I had picked a different song for the background. And he said, no, that's just too loud, too lively, which I thought was good for Harry. He said, play something soft. So then I went back and I remembered this song, Take O Take, because I had to learn it and it was very hard. But anyway, so it just was perfect. And then he came back to me later after I was finished with everything and said to me, what about that song, I'm Just Wild About Harry? Do you think you could find that? So that was kind of the inspiration to put at the end because I could see how wild they were about each other. You're muted, Jeff.
That was a beautiful, beautiful song. And think of the times that we have with some of these people. Wow.
Did you have something, Betty?
Just want a question. And I don't know if you mentioned it. Didn't Harry bring a chair over in on a plane over to India for Baba, a big chair that he, I don't know how I remember that story.
Yeah, I think he brought two chairs. He was very, he wanted Baba and even have a stool for his feet to rest on so that they were not just dangling. And yeah, he took real care of all of the physical movements and positions that Baba would be in so that he would be least affected by the pain.
Another thing I just wanted to mention was that beautiful photo of Carrie meeting Baba.
Wow.
Yeah.
Are you still hearing me, Hal? I think about you. There you are.
Yeah.
I was thinking about it when I saw it because I remember that picture of Carrie Benjamin, but I don't remember that Harry was in it. And when I saw it now, it was so strong. You know, these two people were strong people and different people. Not of the regular kind, and they had great fire of love to bring to both these places. And
and she gesture that she was making, was she making some kind of a gesture?
Was sort of with all her love, she was bowing down and over the candle, and Baba was, if you look at the picture, he was pointing out, watch out, you're gonna burn with this candle.
Beautiful.
And that's the time she met him, and that's the time Harry met him. And they both went to Myrtle Beach after that.
Wow.
So it's interesting that they both got in the same time.
Yeah. You were very much on my mind. I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you, Ruth, for the videos that you do and all those programs. So beautiful.
Thank you,
Jeff, for all those beautiful stories, wonderful stories. Wow.
Yeah.
And also Ira and all the others, Fred and Ken. And beautiful.
Baba arranged for Carrie to go to Myrtle Beach. She didn't have the funds, and Baba had Adele collect money so she could go with the group.
Yeah.
You've got Judy there.
Yeah. Judy, you want to go ahead?
Yeah. Betty, I have just a couple more details on the chairs. In particular, I remember the chair that is now in Baba's bedroom at Marizod. And it was after, I think, the second accident. And Harry knew that chair would give Baba the best support and so forth that he needed afterwards. So he actually he paid for a first class seat on the airplane, and one for himself and one for the chair next to him. And he and the chair, imagine that on our present day airplanes. Anyway, the chair went first class over to India with Harry. And you know how hard it is to travel in India, and in those days it was much harder even. And you know, he's blind, and yet he arrived at Marizod with the chair, you know, intact and so forth. And of course it's been, you know, it served Baba for the rest of his life. And then, you know, how many of us have had a chance to take Darshan at that chair in Baba's room. And it's a ongoing example of Harry's love for Baba.
Yeah. Was it that chair? The chair that's in Mondaley Hall?
Yeah.
No, not in Mondaley Hall.
His bedroom.
But in Baba's room.
Baba's room.
His bedroom. And it's not the one that's directly in front of Baba's bed is called the watchman's chair, but it's it's over, you know, towards the
corner.
You might call the back corner of the room as you come in.
Oh, that's good to know. Thank you.
Yeah, I remember a story about that chair. You see, Harry told Anna Rosa, "You are the same height as Baba, so see how the chair feels." Okay, so she actually sat in. You know, she actually was the height, you know, he actually felt the chair out, if it's comfortable or not, and the right height for Baba, like that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Betty, for the question.
How was Baba?
Say it again.
How tall was Baba?
5'6", I think.
Yeah.
That's not what it says on his passport.
Yeah.
One time Mara looked at me and she says, "Oh, Rosalie, you're tall." I said, "I'm 5'7". And she says, "Oh," she says, "that's good. Baba's taller. 5'8 is what it says on his passport."
Ah.
And she says, "It's better to look up to Baba."
That's great, Rosalie. Do you have any stories or thoughts about Harry, Rosalie?
No, but I think it's funny. Today is Upasi Maharaj's birthday, and you know, I just think he's an earth sign, Upasi, that brought Baba down to earth with a rock. No, this is it's just fascinating to hear how everyone's life with Baba is so different. And I hear the wild character. Yeah.
Yeah, I love the stories about him with the circus and as an entertainer and a singer, and that beautiful photo with the hats up in the air and he's in the middle, you know, at the mic. Just what an entertainer. Yeah.
Yeah.
Baba must have just loved having him around.
Yeah.
That would help you feel better.
You know, one of the most, what I'm most thankful for to Harry for was when I was out in Seattle, I used to kind of get hit by vibrations and have these headaches and things would hit my spine and I was in a lot of pain, just especially if I went around druggy areas in Seattle. And, you know, there was like speed in that place and LSD in that place. I mean, I could, and it really bothered me. I didn't think there was anything I could do about it. And so when I went out there, Harry was, like I say, he was like emanating so much vitality, so much energy that, and he flowed out to life. And I was kind of having to kind of protect myself from these vibrations. And he kind of convinced me, not verbally, but he convinced me to flow out to life, mm-hmm. flow through everything. Now, I mean, I'm just talking, I don't know if this would be helpful to anybody else, but to get your internal vitality, your force field strong enough so that it can flow through everything that you meet, so that you're not shrunken back by what you meet in this life. Because Harry certainly was, you know, right there in front of me, an example of somebody that just flowed through everything, all the way to the corners of the universe, I'm sure. But so I became much more conscious of not being a victim of the outer, of the collective outer vibration, but to flow, build up enough internal vitality so that I could meet life and be with it and not be shrinking from anything. I don't know if that makes sense, but I mean, that was invaluable for me. And I never had those headaches and that, you know, pain on my up and down my spine and everything. So, I mean, he had, you know, he had gone through the realm of energy and got out the other side. So how we, you know, working with our internal vitality is one way we can change our life, you know, our world. So we're not a victim, even if, you know, even, you know, whatever. Anyway, that was an enduring gift from him that I kind of got through osmosis.
Wonderful, Jeff.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for sharing that.
And if you put Baba's name on that,
I was current, thinking
that that current, it strengthens it all the more.
Yeah, it's that trust in the beloved. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just looking around to see if anybody else has any questions. Meher Prasad, go ahead.
I just remember something that Balnath too, I think, used to say about Harry Kenmore. He said that his name in Hindi can also be said as Harry Kenmore, meaning Hari means God or Vishnu. K means his, and more means peacock. So Harry Kenmore means he's God's peacock. And, you know, peacock's feather was something that Lord Krishna used to put in his hair.
And when the peacock's feathers are up, you kind of got Harry Kenmore in multicolor.
That's great, Meher Prasad. Thank you.
Great zest for life.
All right, I'm just seeing anybody else.
I'm reminded on the peacock aspect of Katie Irani, Gohair sister that I think most of you know, and how frustrated she was with Moti the peacock at Upper Maribod when she was cooking and would bring out the food under what is now the tin shed, and Moti would go right in the center and display his beautiful feathers, but they had this ongoing challenge. And in a way, it's a little bit fitting. Harry's exuberance for life didn't always fit well with everyone else around. No. So there's some kind of echo there that I think of.
Yeah, that's great. That's great, Judy. I get it.
He's supposed to fit with Baba, and he did. That is what is important.
Yeah, absolutely. It's just so beautiful, as everyone has already said, just to see how open and what a myriad of people Baba brought close to him that we have now to look to. Whew. Well, I'm just waiting. Yeah. If there's anything else, Jeff, did you have anything?
I don't know if I mean, there's probably things, but nothing is occurring to me.
Okay. And I'm just looking for any hands. Uh-huh. Diana? Jay Baba.
I came in late, so I don't know if you discussed this earlier, but could anyone say something about the way and the goal which was associated with Harry?
We have the link actually in the chat, and I'll put it in again in case you want it. But yeah, somebody did bring up the way and the goal. I think it was Ira. And then Prakash found the PDF online.
Oh, it's on the website. It's on the trust website. I know you can get it. I just didn't know if it had been discussed.
They're transcripts.
You could download it. Okay, download it to your PC.
That's not the issue. It's just what I, how did that come to be? Did you discuss that earlier?
Well, I think Ira, didn't you bring it up, Ira?
Yes, yes. Okay. You see, Doctor gave talks every Saturday night. And wonderful talks. And they were tape recorded. And then during the week, you know, the society group, they would type up, though, from the tape, they would type it up, okay? And then it would be like a booklet of about maybe 4 or 5 pages that they mail out. It was mailed out to maybe about 500 people or so.
And the thing is that, you know, these talks, he would start out with things that he had written on Braille. And the talks would kind of start out a little bit stilted. And he would, you know, kind of, and then at a certain point, he would just lift off the ground and go into these inspired talks, you know, and had left his whatever he was thinking going to say, and he just went off. And it was amazing how inspired the things that he would say. And you can only talk like that if you got it all so simple and deep, profound. It came out of a well of lifelong, one-pointed dedication. Yeah. It's really something.
One of his favorite talks is, "What is a Baba lover?" Okay. And we all come to realize we're Baba enthusiasts. That's his word, Baba enthusiasts. Because a Baba lover is like Hafiz. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. My Baba contact brought that home to me years ago. Same thing. It was like, yeah, thank you.
Where are those? Does somebody have all of those?
I have some of them. I was one of the lucky people back in the late 60s that just was on fire with Baba. And so I started subscribing out in California, and I would so eagerly wait and then receive the way and the goal each month. It was so, it was a lifeline for me because, you know, I hadn't been to the East Coast and been able to meet Harry or get to Myrtle Beach and so forth, but it was, I remember them, and I still have those, all of the issues that I, you know, received.
I wonder if Larry has them and if he'll publish them.
No, it's posted on the chat.
I just reposted.
Yeah.
Yeah, in case you came late, I just reposted on the chat, the site that you can use, PDF site, to bring up the way and the goal. What a great thing to bring forth, Ira. Thank you. Yeah. And I'm trying to think who, Prakash read two pieces that he had come across, and they were just beautiful, Prakash. Just kind of saw them.
Oh, so. I thought of one last story.
Oh, good.
I don't know if I should tell the person's name, but after the meetings on Saturday, you know, we'd be all sitting around the table and, you know, people ask him questions and everything. And this one lady, I don't know if I should give her name, but she, you know, she waxed very poetic about how she wanted to get on the stage and be able to convey Baba to the people, to the masses and everything. And this would be her medium. You know, she's talking way like that. And Harry said, "You know what you need to do, lady? You need to get married and have a bunch of kids." You know, and just, oh God, it was like hurtful. Harry, you know. So then you move ahead about 10 years. And there's this woman and her mother are going around India posing as they're Westerners who are posing as some kind of, I don't know, princess and what and everything, going around to all the Baba centers. And, you know, and I and they come to the pilgrim center, and I recognize it's the same lady.
Oh, no.
Wow, Harry was not that far off. I mean, she's just out there. And then another 15 years later, this lady is coming to the center, and I got the first name, I think, I bet it's her. This lady comes, and she comes with her two sons, and she is so down to earth now. I mean, and when they came to Happy Club, and she was so helpful with Happy Club at the beach. But, and I thought, wow, Harry was right way back when. What she needed is to come down and you know, be grounded with these two boys that she had, and she was fine. But this all unfolded over about 25 years. You know, he was so right on, but oh God, it was painful. "You know what you need to do, woman? You need to get married and have a bunch of kids."
Wow.
That's the way it was.
Wow. So beautiful.
Yeah. Well,
I just want to mention Betty has put a lot of information in the chat about what's going on this weekend, and Erwin Luck was on today at 1:15.
Right, and after this link, one.
Yeah, the link is here. You'll have to use the link because he's not coming on Baba Zoom. It's a different link. But anyway, yeah. A lot and of
isn't
wonderful.
Isn't there
things.
Something for Harry Kenmore tonight? I mean, not for Harry Kenmore, for Bill LePage, something this
That's
afternoon?
This afternoon.
What
yeah.
time?
2:30.
2:30, okay.
Eastern.
Okay. So we can finish up.
Eddie, what is that at 2:30?
It's Bill. He's been ill. Bill had a lung infection. And so the thought is to gather up good wishes and just send him and then send it right along to him.
And it will hard.
Yeah. And we'll go and talk a little bit about his life. And he made a beautiful video, he narrated on the Three Incredible Weeks. My goodness, it's lovely. So we might play some of that.
Beautiful. Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah, it's a very full schedule. Tomorrow is Mara at 11 here. And we're looking forward to celebrating Mara's union with Bob. So again, it's just been an amazing time to revisit these amazing people that Baba had near him. And Jeff, I want to thank you and everyone here for the stories and the love.
Yeah, thanks for the heartfelt memories and
beautiful
our love.
Yeah. Wow, wonderful to know this man.
Yeah, bringing Baba closer to us all. Thank you.
Yeah. Jamie.
Jay Baba, we'll take a moment of silence. Jeff's ready. Jay Baba.
Jay Baba.
Avatar, Meher Baba.
Jay.
Avatar, Meher Baba.
Jay.
Avatar, Meher Baba. Jay. I just want to say something kind of quickly. Years ago, I was at the center and my former husband went out in the morning to take some photographs for Jane Haynes for a book. And he went into Deep Woods Way and down and came across this group of people. And they were bird watching early in the morning. And Bob Holt, who wrote Ocean of Love, was blind and he was with them. And so my former husband kind of sidled up next to him and said, Bob, what would a blind man do bird watching? Bob said, oh, well, I'm actually listening. And if you hear the video bird, and right then this bird was going, video, video, video. Bob said, I'm listening to what the birds are saying and there's the video bird. And so when we, Bob is so sweet. When we just had our moment of silence, the minute we started silence, I heard the video bird. And I heard, and it was Bob Holt coming to visit with Harry Kenmore today. I'll just say Jay Baba to
them. Wow. Oh, that's
thank
great.
You, Jeff.
Thank you, Ruthie.
Sure.